ACE inhibitors are the well-known drugs commonly known as angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. These drugs are used in the treatment of various conditions like hypertension, cardiovascular disorders like heart failure, and kidney disorders like chronic kidney disease. These medications can be identified by their suffix pril. Pril indicates that they have a ring called proline. We have so many types of drugs like captopril, lisinopril, ramipril, enalapril, fosinopril, and so on. Among these, trandolapril and benazepril are widely used ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors produce hard effects. Here, H indicates hyperkalemia, A is angioedema, R is renal failure, and D is dry cough. Even though all these medications end with same suffix, they are not equivalent. Few medications need bioactivation. That means when they are going to be taken into the body, they should be converted into their active metabolites. Interestingly, most of the ACE inhibitors require bioactivation. Except for captopril and lisinopril, all other ACE inhibitors need bioactivation. Captopril and lisinopril are the active drugs that directly act on the renin angiotensin system. However, they have no additional advantages and they are replaced by newer ACE inhibitors. So, in this video, we will discuss the ACE inhibitors, how they act, what are the important side effects, what are their effects on different parts of the body. All such things we will discuss in this video. First of all, let us see the clinical use of ACE inhibitors. One of the widely used indications is in the treatment of hypertension. When the blood pressure is increased, many medications can be given to reduce blood pressure. Among them, ACE inhibitors are one category of drugs that act on renin angiotensin system to control the blood pressure. Particularly, these medications can be given when the blood pressure is above 140/90. They can be given either alone or they can be combined with other antihypertensive agents based on the elevation in the blood pressure. The second clinical indication is in the treatment of heart failure. Particularly, they are given in the treatment of systolic heart failure. The heart is unable to pump due to the reduced functioning of the systolic phase. In such conditions, the ejection fraction of the heart is going to be reduced due to a decreased rate of contraction. ACE inhibitors are given to reduce the workload of the heart as they reduce blood pressure as well as they inhibit renin angiotensin system. Therefore, they can improve the symptoms of heart failure. They reduce cardiac work and improve the pumping capacity. So in such people, the ejection fraction can be restored by reducing the blood pressure. They can also reduce the sodium load in the body, which further reduces the cardiac work and improves the symptoms of heart failure. They also reduce the risk of further damage in the heart failure. Therefore, in people with heart failure, ACE inhibitors are used as first-line agents. ACE inhibitors also reduce the progression of cardiac dysfunction and they can be given after heart attack to improve cardiac function. They can increase the survival in the people with cardiovascular disease. Another clinical indication of ACE inhibitors is in the treatment of chronic kidney disease. In people with chronic kidney disease, the filtering capacity of the renal system is reduced. In such conditions, the renin angiotensin system can produce further damage. One of the important mediators in the renin angiotensin system is angiotensin II, which is acting as a potent vasoconstrictor. It causes a contraction of blood vessels supplying to the renal system, particularly at the efferent arterioles. This reduces the blood flow to the kidneys, which further reduces the filtering capacity. This also increases damage to the kidneys and excretion of protein in the urine. Now, ACE inhibitors are given in the treatment of chronic kidney disease, where they reduce the blood pressure, thereby they improve the functioning of kidneys. Again here, ACE inhibitors play an important role by reducing the blood pressure. When the blood pressure is reduced, the kidney function is going to be improved. It also reduces the amount of protein in the urine. Even they improve the renal blood flow and increase the sodium excretion. Therefore, ACE inhibitors can be used as first-line agents in people with chronic kidney disease. They are also delaying the progression of kidney disease. That's why in the early stage of kidney disease, ACE inhibitors are highly preferred. They can also be given in the people with diabetic nephropathy. The elevated levels of glucose can produce a reduction in the renal function. High levels of glucose may damage the blood vessels in the kidneys, which reduce the filtering ability of the kidneys, leading to nephropathy. ACE inhibitors can reduce blood pressure and they can reduce the progression of nephropathy in people with diabetes. Now let us see how ACE inhibitors work. ACE inhibitors are going to inhibit the renin-angiotensin system. This system is activated when the blood pressure is low. The blood pressure is detected by a few of the sensory receptors called baroreceptors. These baroreceptors can detect the low blood pressure at the arterial blood vessels and they can stimulate the release of renin. Renin can also be released by detecting low levels of sodium in the renal tubules. Even sympathetic system can also stimulate the release of renin. Once released, this renin acts as a cleavage enzyme that can convert the angiotensinogen to the angiotensin 1. The angiotensinogen is a precursor that is synthesized in the liver and it is transported to the kidney, where it is going to be converted into angiotensin 1 by the action of renin. Now, this angiotensin 1 cannot directly act on the blood vessels. Instead, it is going to be converted into another mediator, angiotensin 2. This conversion is carried by an enzyme called angiotensin converting enzyme, ACE. Now, ACE can convert the angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. This angiotensin 2 has several roles in the body and it can affect many of the organs. One of its primary actions is on the blood vessels, where it can activate angiotensin 2 receptors, leading to the increased entry of sodium. This results in the contraction of blood vessels, leading to increase in the blood pressure. Angiotensin 2 also acts on the heart. It can modulate cardiac signaling and increase the proliferation of the heart. And the role of angiotensin 2 is in the secretion of aldosterone. It is a hormone that is responsible for reabsorption of sodium at the renal tubules. By elevating the sodium levels, angiotensin 2 helps in restoring the blood pressure. The third action of angiotensin 2 is on the hypertrophy. It is the proliferation of muscles that results in the increased thickness as well as the loss of their function. Angiotensin 2 can increase the proliferation of vascular smooth muscle as well as cardiac muscle, which impairs their functionality. However, this hypertrophy is observed on long-term activation of renin-angiotensin system. So in people with excessive stimulation of the renin-angiotensin system, more angiotensin 2 is released, leading to hypertrophy. Therefore, even though angiotensin 2 is required for restoring the blood pressure, the action of angiotensin 2 should be properly controlled in order to reduce the damage to the blood vessels and cardiac system. Now, ACE inhibitors can inhibit the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Thereby, they inhibit all actions of angiotensin 2. It results in a decrease in the blood pressure as well as an increased excretion of sodium. They also reduce hypertrophy, thereby preventing or delaying the damage of few organs by excessive activation of renin-angiotensin system. Dry cough produced by ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors can produce dry cough, which is commonly observed in many people. This may be observed even with the first dose, or it can be developed after a few months of the therapy. This dry cough is because of accumulation of bradykinin in the body. Normally, ACE enzyme is responsible for metabolism of bradykinin. However, when ACE inhibitors are used, the metabolism of bradykinin is going to be inhibited, leading to the accumulation of bradykinin levels. This results in the development of dry cough in the people. Normally, this dry cough may be resolved after 1 month of stopping therapy, but sometimes it may last up to 3 months. This dry cough may be more troublesome during the night and it may interfere with the sleep. So if you observe any dry cough, ACE inhibitors may be discontinued. Effect on potassium levels. Another important side effect of ACE inhibitors is the hyperkalemia. Since they are going to inhibit the actions of angiotensin 2, they prevent the secretion of aldosterone. Aldosterone is responsible for reabsorption of sodium and water from renal tubules into the body. This allows the potassium to enter into the urine. When the actions of aldosterone is blocked, sodium is not reabsorbed into the systemic circulation and it is excreted in the urine. This prevents the potassium from entering into the urine. Therefore, the potassium is more retained in the body. This leads to elevated levels of potassium, leading to hyperkalemia. With elevated levels of potassium, people may have few symptoms like weakness, confusion, and muscle cramps. When it is excessively elevated, it can also produce palpitations and increased heart rates in the people. This hyperkalemia can also be pronounced when AC inhibitors are combined with other medications, which again increase potassium levels. Particularly, potassium-sparing diuretics like imlaride, triamterene, and spironolactone may also increase hyperkalemia. Taking potassium supplements along with AC inhibitors and potassium-rich foods can also increase the risk of hyperkalemia. So when you are taking AC inhibitors, a high consumption of potassium-rich foods like dry fruits, leafy vegetables, sweet potatoes, carrots may increase the risk of hyperkalemia. So while you are using AC inhibitors for longer periods, particularly at higher doses, try to avoid high consumption of potassium-rich foods. Angioedema. Another effect of AC inhibitors is the angioedema. It is a fatal condition that results in the swelling of skin, lips, face, tongue, and throat. This is a hypersensitive reaction that may be observed with AC inhibitors. It can be observed within the first few weeks of the treatment and results in difficulty breathing, trouble swallowing, nausea, and abdominal pain. Whenever you observe the symptoms of angioedema, immediately the drug should be stopped. Even other drugs in the same category should be avoided, because once this hypersensitivity is observed with one drug in this category, it can also be observed with all other drugs in this category. After stopping the dose of this medication, the swelling can be slowly reduced within a period of 3 months. Renal artery stenosis. Renal artery stenosis is a condition of the narrowing of blood vessels supplying the kidneys. Due to the narrowing of blood vessels, the filtering capacity of the kidneys is reduced. Even though AC inhibitors can improve the kidney function by reducing the blood pressure, but they are not suitable in a condition called bilateral artery stenosis, where the blood vessels are constricted in both efferent as well as afferent arterioles. In such conditions, the kidney function is highly reduced. Even though AC inhibitors improve the blood flow at afferent arterioles, they lack action at efferent arterioles. Therefore, in people with bilateral artery stenosis, the filtering capacity is further declined with use of AC inhibitors. Hence, they should be avoided in this condition. Even AC inhibitors can precipitate acute renal failure in people with hypotension, poor perfusion, or severe diarrhea. Next one is the fetal toxicity. AC inhibitors can produce teratogenic effects. Therefore, they should not be given in the pregnant woman. They can reduce the fetal renal function and they may also lead to renal failure. They can reduce the amniotic fluid, which may lead to the poor development of lungs and reduces its growth. An underdevelopment of skull bone may also result in birth defects. Therefore, in pregnant women, AC inhibitors are contraindicated. Now let us see what are the side effects of AC inhibitors. AC inhibitors mainly produce few side effects that are related to their lowering of blood pressure. One of the important side effects is the dizziness and lightheadedness. They can also produce hypotension as an important side effect. Other side effects like headache, nausea, fatigue, and dry mouth can be observed. They can also increase the chest pain and blurred vision. They elevate potassium levels that may lead to hyperkalemia. In a few people, angioedema can be observed, leading to the swelling of face, lips, and tongue. Dry cough is another important side effect that is commonly observed. So these are the various important things about AC inhibitors. AC inhibitors are widely used in the conditions like heart failure, chronic kidney disease, diabetic nephropathy, as well as they are mainly used in the treatment of hypertension. The main function of AC inhibitors is to reduce the blood pressure and to increase the sodium excretion. Thereby, they improve the function of heart as well as kidneys. They can be used as first-line agents in many of the conditions to delay the progression of particular disease and reduce the mortality in the people. However, they can produce dry cough as one of the important side effects, which is commonly observed with all drugs in this category. Hyperkalemia is another important effect that can be observed with long-term use of AC inhibitors. Dizziness, hypotension, fatigue, and drowsiness can also be produced by ACE inhibitors. In a few people, these medications can produce angioedema, resulting in the swelling of face, lip, and tongue. In people with bilateral artery stenosis and in the pregnant woman, use of ACE inhibitors are contraindicated. So that's all about the ACE inhibitors. I hope this video is useful to you. If you really like this video, please subscribe to our channel and hit the like button to support our work. Please share this video with your friends and post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching. See you in the next video.